I'm very pleased to have introduced Indy Hurt.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited to be here today. It's been many years since I've been here at the University of Redlands. I really love maps, so I'm really excited to talk to you a little bit about that. I actually had a sound check slide at the beginning. I know some of you are here. Does anybody want to see a little bit of the sound check slide? Let's see if I can get it to play.
Hey, Brian, let's get a real lock up there, please. Steve, guys, stop working for just a second. Rolling, ready?
Rolling.
House lights. Stage. Action, Nick. Roll playback.
Yeah, you roll.
That song, it's like my anthem, Maps. They don't love you like I love you. She says it like 15 times throughout the song. I won't tell you what she's really referring to for this audience. She's talking about maps literally. So please don't look it up. So yes, my name is Indy, and I am going to give you this slide that tells you what I'm going to talk about, a little bit about me, actually a lot about me, because when you work in industry, that is the one thing that you're allowed to talk about. This bit about I'm a cartographer, you're a cartographer, we are all cartographers, it's really controversial. Some people will argue against this. I'm going to argue for it, that we are all making maps. Then there's this concept of data being everywhere. You may be exposed to that here at the university. If you go into industry, get ready. And finally, a little bit about things that you might want to think about learning while you're here and beyond, what you might want to approach once you get into an industry position. So starting out with education. I went to community college forever. Did anybody here spend any time in community college? All right, those are my people. This is where I learned how to be a student. I learned on the cheap. I went on and off for several years. There's like a couple gaps in there because I didn't really know what I wanted to do. But eventually I decided, if I string these classes together just so, maybe I can actually get a degree. And it's really interesting. I originally was really hoping to get into UCI and into a social ecology program. And a geography professor at the end of my time at UCSB convinced me that I should really consider geography. So I applied to UCLA, and lo and behold, I got accepted. So that's how I ended up there. And the interesting thing is, by the time I got to UCLA, I was 30 years old when I graduated, but I had braces, so no one knew that I wasn't the same age as everyone else. It was awesome. I think the only thing that gave it away for the people in my class was when we had finals and I stayed in the faculty house. And they're like, how are you able to afford to stay in the faculty house? I'm like, oh, I have a full-time job. So that kind of gave me away. But the interesting thing is I might have been a late bloomer, but there are lots of late bloomers in life. And if you think about these three women, you got Julia Childs and Martha Stewart, Vera Wang, I have to throw in a fashion person because I do work at a company. I'm not just an independent scholar, so a fashion reference has to get in here. And all of these women, they didn't really start doing the thing that they're most famous for until they reached their 30s. So I'm kind of in a pretty cool cohort. And I'll say that up until I started graduate school, even when I was doing my undergrad, I was bartending high volume nightclubs. And it was a completely different lifestyle going from bartending to academia to industry. And people are always interested, like, well, how did you make that transition? Well, I'll tell you, it totally was not graceful, but I made it out onto the other side, and I'm better for it having had that experience. And there's not a lot of time to discuss the whole bartending part of my life, but some of the skills that I picked up there actually come into play now in my experience in industry. And if you remind me, I might tell you some of those stories. So back to UCLA. When I was there, I got my very first mapping job through the School of Epidemiology, the Department of Epidemiology that was in the School of Public Health. And that's actually a picture of me at that time. And what you see in my hand is a map tube. And inside is a paper map of some part of the Central Valley, California, water use based on crop type. So this study was looking at the relationship between early onset Parkinson's disease and pesticide exposure. And I was so excited to be part of this project because it was like a real world experience, but kind of in a research way. There was like high stakes, but low stakes at the same time. And I was needed. And I really wanted to be like the extension of the computer. And I would sit there and the doctors would come in, like not PhDs, but like the actual doctors that help people. And and they would be discussing the different types of pesticides, and I knew all of them, and every once in a while they would use a term or they would say the whole word for the pesticide instead of just the acronym, and I would stop. Like, I wouldn't know what to do, and they would forget that there's an actual person here who is kind of doing the analysis on the fly, and I would finally look up and say, I don't know that pesticide. What else is it called? I'm like, it's BO2, and then I would be able to generate the map for them so they could see what they were interested in seeing concentrations of. So I really loved this project, and all of my projects through undergrad and graduate had some public health component from there on. So it's an interesting path from UCLA. I got exposed to GIS really early on. It was actually, from community college to UCLA, I was a little bit intimidated. So I took a course in the summer before my actual semester started, or quarters, they're on the quarter system. And I had a choice between some regional class, part of the world that I wasn't interested in, I don't even remember which one it was, and GIS. Didn't know what GIS was, but I figured it should be interesting. And I was hooked right from the start. And that professor, who happened to be a grad student, explained to me what the path forward was. And the University of Redlands was one of those opportunities. And so I applied and I ended up here. And that was 2005. So I went from LA out here, and I graduated, and I ended up taking a job at Esri. And I was in educational services, so I loved it. I was going around the country teaching people how to use GIS. And back then it was just ArcMap. There wasn't too much web-based GIS that people were really doing. It was more like how to use different extensions that were currently popular at the time. But around the same time as finishing my master's and going to Esri to take this job, I got recruited for a PhD program that I was really interested in Santa Barbara. So I went back to academia with a sizable amount of student debt. And I figured, I'll figure that out later. It was really interesting while I was there. So when I first got to UCSB, when you do an academic program at a school like UCSB, the funding comes usually from one of three sources. One might be that you are a teaching assistant, another might be that you're a research assistant, and then the other is you get funding through some big package or through a different agency. And in my case, for the first summer, I had an opportunity to be a teaching assistant with another graduate student. And I also got funding to go to the ESRI user conference. And so he says, when you go to the conference, I want you to talk to as many people as you can, interview them, and ask them, what is the most important cartographic principle? And I'm like, oh boy. So hopefully you all are thinking about that right now. And I get there and I'm really intimidated. I don't know anybody. It's a huge conference. There's anywhere from 10 to 15,000 people there. And I got really very lucky because on my first day, I happened to go up to the information booth and I see these two guys standing there and I read their name badge and it was someone that I knew, but I had never seen this person. This person is responsible for doing a podcast called the Very Spatial Podcast, and usually they are the ones that interview everyone else. So I see a few people like saying, oh, Very Spatial Podcast, that's what they look like. They never, ever, ever want to be in this position. So I asked them, what is the most important cartographic principle? And here's what they said. All right, you ready for the question?
Shoot.
What is the most important cartographic principle?
Oh, I want Frank here first. Poli-sci. Yeah, this is funny because, I really don't know much about cartography, which is a little bit sad because I come from more of a technical background and more into the engine and how to make it all work. But I think the most important principle is if you're not conveying information, you've screwed it up somehow. And so you really need to sometimes unfocus and not focus so much on the details and look at the whole map and say, does this say what it's supposed to say? If the answer is no, then it needs to maybe start from ground zero.
Jesse, would you like to weigh in?
I'm going to stay away from principles. I think I'm going to go with good cartographic standards being read every book by McEachran, Robinson, and lots of other people.
Find some other people?
Huh?
Find some other people?
No. see, he took a good, well, it wasn't principles, but Sue has to answer the question too, so you can ask the question while
Sue, come on in.
We're being filmed, we're being asked a general question. Cartographic principles, you got one.
What's the most important?
What's the most important cartographic principle? Your opinion.
I'm just going to go with color theory, because if you don't have good colors, it's just not.
That's a good one.
Know what you're symbols are telling people.
That's a good one, too.
Yes, important. Symbology counts.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
That's a quote I'm going to use.
Symbology counts, yeah.
Is that good?
That's awesome. I was so happy. It was the first day. My job is done. I could just enjoy the rest of the conference. These are some of the things that they said. If you didn't pick up, the audio is not great because I was using a really terrible camera. If you're not conveying information, you've screwed it up somehow. I think we can all agree with this. Read all the classics, McEachran, Robinson, Mark Monnier for How to Lie with Maps is another great one that he should have referenced. Know what your symbols are telling people. Symbology counts, trademark. It seems like if you've been to the ESRI user conference, couldn't you just see symbology counts on one of those big banners? The things that they had to say were really compelling, and it was a fun exercise for me. That same night, I happened to run into Aileen Buckley, and I'm hoping that some of you have met her, and if you haven't, I hope that you have the opportunity. She is a cartographic researcher at ESRI. I think she is the only cartographic researcher I know working in industry that I personally know. She is fantastic. I have a video of her as well, and I did kind of promise that I would not show it anymore because she's like, oh my gosh, I look terrible. So have this lovely headshot of my dear friend Aileen, and her response was, communicate your message. So there's a theme here about communicating. And if you ever have the opportunity to interact with Aileen at a conference, something amazing is probably going to happen because she just tends to make things happen. And about 100 feet away was Jack Dangerman talking to someone fairly important, I'm sure, probably, I don't know, some dignitary of some sort. And Aileen drags me across the floor and says, you have to ask Jack this question. So here I am, this unknown graduate student, and I have to ask Jack Dangerman, the president of ESRI, ESRI, the same question. And here is what he had to say. It's a little, the audio's a little bit terrible, but I'll play it.
All right, what is the most important cartographic principle?
Creating a map that communicates. Is that a principle? I don't know. Well, that's what I think anyway.
That's excellent.
Roger Thompson always talked about know what you need to communicate, build the information product that is responsive for what is needed and wanted. So discovery of what's needed and wanted is a rare, well, it's a rare talent to find somebody who actually understands how to determine what's needed and wanted. The most successful people in the world have figured it out, what's needed and wanted. So that's my advice to my students. Figure that out, you got your whole life.
Actually sounds like a great description for Steve Jobs. He was one of those visionaries that seemed to always be able to figure out what was needed and wanted, and he was very successful for that. It was such a great experience at this conference to ask these varied individuals about what the most important cartographic principle was, and for them all to narrow down into the same thing, that it has a lot to do with communication. And I was really lucky. When I was in grad school, I had a lot of experiences like this where I got to interact with people from all different walks, all different disciplines, people from all over the world. It kind of helped that I was in Santa Barbara, so it was really easy to convince them to come to Santa Barbara. Otherwise, I don't know how I would have had so many opportunities. And once I finished grad school, I wasn't really quite sure, even before I finished, what I wanted to do, specifically. I just wanted to make sure that I was prepared for every opportunity. And tenure track faculty positions, there are more graduating PhDs than there are tenure track faculty positions. But I knew, and my committee was aware of it before even I knew, that I was far more applied, or I was just much more driven by applied science than I was with contributing to the existing body of knowledge with research that would potentially develop into a mainstream tool maybe 15, 20 years down the road. My dissertation was agent-based modeling of infectious diseases, and it was really innovative and groundbreaking, but it'll be a long time before it becomes a mainstream methodology within business, within public health. I still really value that research, but I really wanted to do something now with the tools that were available. And so that's kind of how I took the leap from academia into industry. This is an interesting experience that I had. So I graduated, I went to Kenya, I spent a little bit of time there. I was actually interested in potentially helping ESRI open an office in Nairobi to support the United Nations environmental program. And I don't think it actually happened, but it was appealing to me. It would have only been a 2-year opportunity, but like, who wouldn't want to go overseas and have that amazing experience? And I came back to New York. I was interested in leading GIS for the city's public health department. Actually, they call it New York City Public Health and Mental Hygiene, which is quite a mouthful, but I was ready to lead that team. My timing was not right, so I wasn't able to apply and be part of the first round. And at the same time, AAG, which is a big conference for geography nerds like myself, was happening in New York. I ran into one of my former students, and she was working at Apple. So if any of you are in a position to teach or coach students, you just never know when they are going to be the ones offering you the opportunity. Luckily for me, I've always been really good to my students, so she was really happy to help me get into Apple. And it was a very long process. So this is something that I did not heed from my advisors when I was in grad school, and that was to start like a year before I was expected to graduate. I didn't start looking for positions until I graduated, because all I cared about was graduating. I got to a point where I was just, I need to be done, and I focused all my energy there. And then I figured, oh, I'll figure out something, and I did. But if I had started planning earlier, I might have got that job in New York. But I was really happy to end up at Apple. And then things got really interesting, which is a good segue into, I'm a cartographer, you're a cartographer, we are all cartographers. How many of you make maps? Okay. For those of you that were raising your hands because you've made a map or make maps, do you also identify as cartographers? Ooh, no one wants to put their hand back up. Maybe like one, two, three. Oh, this table over here. Do they count? Yes, they count. What about business intelligence, like data? How many of you work with business data? Okay, quite a few. And of those of you that put your hand up, would you keep your hand up if you also identify as a data scientist? Oh, there's one, there's two. This table. So there's a couple, but most of you decided, oh, no, I don't identify that. And do any of you have to interact with a database and maybe write some SQL? So a few people. So the interesting thing that I would want to say to all of you is, if you're working with data and you're doing analytics on data, you might fall into the data science category. If you are making any sort of map, you may also fall into the cartographer category. And the reason why I'm pointing this out is because what I discovered when I went to industry is that everyone's making maps. They're doing it in different ways, and they're using all these different tools to be able to arrive at something that displays something on a map. You can look at Tableau, and you might be able to generate a map there. The one that I often have to support is Power BI by Microsoft. Oh my goodness, Microsoft, so late to the game. But you can just put in a spreadsheet with lat longs and you can display the map inside of Power BI. Then there is the whole suite of Esri tools that you can use to generate maps. And it's not just geographers. It's not just business, MBAs and business intelligence analysts. There are all kinds of interesting people who are trying to convey some information on a map. And not all of them have the background that you may be exposed to or that I've been exposed to. And so it can be this really interesting place of, oh my gosh, like what do? Everyone's making maps, nobody has read the classics. So I thought that was really interesting. And I also find a lot of parallels in music. So I'll show you a couple of examples. This is Sarah Bareilles, and I bet some of you have heard of her.
Tell me to breathe easy for
I almost stopped it right before the chorus to mess you guys up. I'm guessing a lot of you have heard it. Sarah Bareilles, I love her. She went to UCLA. I went to UCLA. She sang in an a cappella choir. I currently sing in an a cappella choir. I'm part of the Threshold Choir, which is a whole nother side of my life. And the interesting thing is she is self-taught. So you saw her rocking out on that piano. She taught herself how to play the piano. She also plays the guitar. She taught herself how to play the guitar. So if you think about that, she's not classically trained. She didn't go to college to study music per se, but she's making music. You would consider her an artist. You would consider her, what she just did as music. She's actually very successful, and she has composed quite a bit of music. That song that you just heard was kind of forced on her by her producers when she first got started. They said, you really need to write like a love song, like, you know, something that is approachable to everyone. She says, I'm not gonna write you a love song, and then it turned into the song that you just heard. So I thought it was really interesting that it's kind of like this parallel between cartography and geography and data science. If you're doing it, then you might as well take on some of those titles and own them. It's not all about people who are been trained and have gone to college and have the degrees with those specific names in the degrees. Once you kind of, sometimes you have to like fake it until you make it. And you might experience a lot more of that than you might expect when you hit industry. Here's another example. This is Tori Amos. There's a lot of young people in this audience. I'm gonna guess a lot of you won't know who she is, but she's really awesome too.
Is not a really happening. You bet your life it is. You bet your life it is. You bet your life. It's a peer out the watch will just peer out the watch
will. So here's this rocker girl. Maybe I'm introducing some of you to her for the first time. Here she is playing two pianos at the same time. Anybody here play piano? So a couple of people, piano right here. Before you leave, sit at this piano and try to use your left foot to dampen the piano. It's just like, it blows my mind. That's what she's doing here in like one of these shots. And the interesting thing about Tori Amos is she is classically trained. Oh my goodness. Not only is she classically trained, she was actually a child musical prodigy. She started out in she was 2 years old. She was self-taught, if that counts. But she ended up going to the Peabody Conservatory of Music from the ages 5 to 11. She dropped out because she had outgrown the institute and was too busy trying to do her own thing. And she identifies first as a composer, and she says she just happens to play the piano and sing. I think she's doing more than just playing the piano and singing. But the point that this all, the full circle point of this is that you may be classically trained. You're getting the education here to think spatially, but over the course of your career, you may have to reinvent yourself once, twice, maybe over and over again. And she's definitely reinvented herself many times over the course of her career. I think she still has the occasional tour, I would love to go see her because she's such an amazing musician. And I'd like to think that her classical training has contributed in her ability to adapt. So that's something that I offer to you. You have been exposed to some classical training in spatial analysis and mapping in business, and perhaps some of that is going to enable you to adapt in ways that the self-taught people may not be able to do. You might be able to avoid some of the pitfalls that self-taught people make. I'm not saying that Sarah Bareilles is making a bunch of mistakes. She seems to be doing quite well. I'm not saying that the cartographers that I've encountered that haven't been classically trained have all been making a lot of mistakes. Notice I said all. Some of them have made a tremendous amount of mistakes. But it's just something to consider. And when you interact with people that are doing what you were trained to do without having the formal training that you've received, what is your responsibility? On one hand, you have so much on your plate already. When are you going to have time to help correct people for making the mistakes that you were trained to avoid? You may feel like you don't have the opportunity or the time to do that, but I want to encourage you to think about that, because you want to build up the use of spatial analysis within your field, and you can't do it alone. Bringing people up with you is going to have you, it's going to lend the support that you need to further the path within that context. So data, there are so much data. Oh my goodness. So here's the thing that I have encountered in my experiences in industry. When I was in grad school, there weren't really any courses that really delved into big data. There wasn't anything that integrated AWS or Azure or Google Cloud. Everything was manageable. Even my dissertation, I built a synthetic population and only had 400,000 people in it. That's not big data. These agents were interacting in an environment that I could contain on a laptop. I could not scale. And I needed to be able to scale to really add context or to see whether or not it was going to be a viable approach to investigating this disease diffusion that I was working on. And now you find that you might be able to come up with a proof of concept, and maybe a spreadsheet of data is enough for you to be able to kind of prove out that concept. But to scale, if you don't have the skills up front to scale, then your next best bet is to be able to communicate what you need, kind of going back to a little bit about what we were talking about, communicating your message through maps. You might have to communicate your message well before you start doing the data visualization to get the help you need to scale up the analysis that you're hoping to do. And it's funny because in grad school, I didn't know anything about AWS or S3 or how to deploy an instance and connect the two. And I do that all the time. And I just work for a clothing company. I guess also the thing that I wanted to mention here is not only do we have data coming from all over, having the skills to evaluate the validity of that data is paramount. You're going to come in contact with so much terrible data, and people are going to try to sell it to you. So what do? You can't just take it at face value, this is a reputable company, and they're offering to sell me sales data for competitors, or they're offering to sell me street data for a specific company. You're going to have to be able to negotiate the opportunity to evaluate that data. And then once you get that opportunity, you have a very short amount of time to actually evaluate whether or not that's something that you want to advocate your company purchase. So it's really important. I think we're kind of living in this world right now, we have fake news that's kind of bringing people to the realization that not everything that comes to us is true. We should have known that long ago. And then we also just have just sensors. I mean, I walk around with a little computer with me all the time. It has a whole bunch of sensors, and it's collecting data continuously. And there are so many ways for you to tap into this data. There are so many companies that will sell you my data. I buy your data all the time. So keep that in mind. How do you interact with that data? So we're also in a time where data really should be the first step. It shouldn't be the first step in your process. When I go to approach a problem, the first thing that I was taught to think about was, what's the research question? And then, what methodologies would be appropriate to try to get at that answer for this research question? And then from there, what data? In industry, sometimes it's the opposite. Here's all this data, find something in this data. And that's really not the best way to go about business intelligence. And again, remember, I am Indy, the independent scholar. I am Indy, one of the directors for CAGIS. I am not speaking on behalf of any particular company. This is like my own personal perspective, is that it's not the right approach to just look at a big pile of data and try to extract information. Sometimes that's the only option you have, but you really should sit down, if you can, just for a short amount of time and brainstorm, what do you really want to understand? And you might find that the data that you have is not adequate. And you need to be able to communicate that so that you can get what you need, or at least advocate for that. So learning this and that and being proactive about it, here is the area that I want to offer to both the students in the room and to the faculty in the room. I'm looking at this one table over here that raised their hand for everything that I asked. You need opportunities to communicate with other disciplines that can help you. So when you get dropped into the business context and you need to scale, how do you communicate? If you don't speak the language of the software engineers or the database engineers, then you're going to have a really tough time leveraging those groups. And chances are you're really going to need those groups to further your approach. There's a lot of interesting opportunities in business that really lend themselves so well to GIS. It's so exciting. And I can think of a company that makes clothing, and every aspect of the business could incorporate GIS. Where to put stores, inventory, loss prevention, charitable acts within the community. There's so many different things. Even environmental issues can be approached from a GIS perspective. And I'm preaching to the choir. You all have had opportunities to hear all these different approaches. You've had speakers come out and talk about different types of analyses. And I bet that some of you have gravitated to some talks more than others, thinking, I would love to do this type of thing, but for X company. And when the opportunity comes for you to apply for those positions, there's definitely some things to think about. You will be able to sell your skill set above the average business intelligence analyst because you have some exposure to spatial. That I definitely want to make sure that you're aware of that. And so if you go in, you go for your interview, you have your portfolio, you really sell spatial, and the company brings you in on the basis of that, but they don't have any spatial foundation yet. How do you implement it? What if they don't license any Esri products? What do you do? Who do you talk to? who do you have to bend to your will to get what you need? And I really hope that you will rise to that occasion. But the reality is that chances are, you know, this is like one little sliver of what makes you who you are in this process of getting your degree or being a part of this academic program. And you probably never wanted to sign up to deploy ArcGIS Enterprise for a company. You are going to have to work within the confines of a company's IT department. And imagine you approach the IT department and say, I really want to do GIS and I want to have ArcGIS portal, or I want to interact with ArcGIS online, and here's the architecture from, you know, like a Esri website, and I need port 2700 open and 6080 and what ports? 2700, what is that? Like, you're gonna get shut down. They're gonna be like, no, you can't open all these ports. So it's really hard, like, if you need to communicate with your IT on what you need. And I think this is one of the things that's missing in the academic portion of our training, is that we can't be expected to do it all. You can't be expected to get some, like, a minor in computer science, a minor in data science, a minor in database architecture, and then get your business degree. It's like you are going to get exposed to a couple of, like, a little bit of that, and then your focus is the business degree. So leverage the other departments to get that exposure. It would be so exciting for a computer science student to be able to build your concept. So maybe, like, in tandem, you could work on a project together. Now, I don't know where you're going to find the time to do this. That part I haven't really thought out. But I encourage you to try to find the time. You're going to have to be really proactive in order to do that. So I mentioned here are just some of the cloud environments that you might be exposed to in industry. And I think if I were out on the job market and there was a company that I was interested in, if they had no GIS, I might steer clear. If I wanted to continue doing GIS, I might be more interested in a company that had some. And so far, all of the companies I've worked for have had varying levels of GIS. But to start from scratch, that's a tall order. I'm just one person. And you really need to have champions in the executive branch of your company. You need somebody who's going to speak on your behalf. So it's definitely something to keep in mind. So I have this interesting slide. This poor student graduating has, like, a ton of debt. This is kind of a little bit why I ended up in industry, because I have a degree from this institution. And it was quite expensive. I needed to pay back that student debt. So that's part of how I ended up there. But I also, I think I referenced this earlier, that I was always very applied. And it's really exciting to be able to make a contribution and use the skills that you have to see something that's tangible right now. Instead of, like, long term, you can really focus in on some projects that really could benefit from taking a spatial approach. And also, all of my degrees have taken me a long way. And I also mentioned that I wanted to be prepared for every opportunity. So there are definitely quite a few business analysts that I've interacted with, not just where companies that I've currently work with, but just networking in San Francisco. And not all of them have master's degrees. So there's one. If you end up with a master's degree, you've got to jump on those people that make it into industry. And then there's also there's not very many that have PhDs, because that's kind of a weird thing. But I have a PhD, and it happened to be really advantageous for me. But at the same time, I've had companies worry that I was going to be a flight risk. But I leveraged that by getting the companies to allow me to do the types of research and grow the types of programs that I'm most interested in. Because they know, like, if I'm bored, I'm not going to stay. And so that might be something that's really interesting and advantageous to you as well. And then there's, I will talk a little bit about the Bay Area in general. Another thing that I remember from grad school that kind of made me not want to go so much towards academia was this underlying responsibility to be the face of diversity. And I really did not embrace that. There were all these check boxes. First generation, underrepresented, woman of color, woman in science. It was a lot of pressure. And I kind of saw the ugly underbelly of academia because I sat on a lot of committees and I went to a research one, and it's not the experience of everyone else. But what I found really interesting is I was thinking, okay, I'm gonna get out of academia because I don't wanna be on the committee and I don't wanna be the one that has to recruit all the people of color. I didn't really embrace the whole diversity thing. I wanted to stand on my own two feet as a scientist. I wanted to be regarded as competent and talented regardless of gender and the color of my skin and the field that I was in. So I thought industry, oh boy. It doesn't stop in academia. It is something that you would experience in industry as well. Especially if you are in the Bay Area, you have a lot of it there. And it took me a while to really understand what was so special about diversity. And there's a lot of things. And hopefully you hear some of those things about what's important about diversity. I'm only really going to share one of those things with you. And that has to do with having a broader spectrum of problem-solving skills. If you have a diverse team, people that come from different backgrounds, different genders, they are going to have different problem-solving skills. And if you think about it, if you all come from the same skill set and you solve problems the same way every time, you might be missing out on some opportunity to optimize, some opportunity to do something better or different. But if you bring together people from different backgrounds, from different countries, suddenly you might find something that works much better. And that's one of the key areas of diversity that I've really been able to see throughout my career. So, some of you, the diversity might not necessarily be like your gender or the color of your skin. It might be you are the diversity because you are spatial. So think about that. You're going to come into a company and you are immediately going to be thinking differently. And that's a good thing because you might help solve problems in ways that these companies hadn't thought about before. So we still have a lot to learn about diversity. And there's also this component that falls in the realm of mentorship and advocacy. And I want to just talk about that for a minute. So you have all these different people. They've all come together. Everybody needs a little bit of mentorship, whether you want to admit it or not. And I think everyone here understands what mentorship is. And it continues throughout your career. It might be something like you get a corporate mentor and they give you career advice. They tell you, like, what would you like to accomplish while you're here at this company? And you're like, well, you know what? I really want to be like senior director of location intelligence for this company, and I want to have a team of like 15 GIS analysts, and I just want to take over the world. And they're like, okay, as a mentor, they might tell you, in order to accomplish that, you need to demonstrate your ability to carry out projects and present research and be succinct, and you need to be dependable and trustworthy, and you need to garner influence. Those sound like great mentoring comments, but mentoring doesn't really get you as far as you need to get. You need it to be paired with advocacy. So telling me what I need to do to get to this place of being like a senior director is one thing, but opening doors for me is another way that really is gonna propel people to that next step. And in, I guess in an academic context, it might be not only helping you to figure out what you need to do for your project, but it might be that your faculty member takes the time to actually nominate you for a specific award or grant. That's something that they're doing on your behalf. And this is really important with respect to maybe getting some of these people that are from a diverse background, helping them to advance within the companies. They need advocates. And if you're thinking, this doesn't apply to me, I'm just, you know, I'm not a diverse person, I'm just like the average person, I'm just coming into a company, I don't really have to think too much about diversity, but you actually do, because you can be an advocate at any level. You can say, you can speak on behalf of one of your coworkers at any time and say, hey, this person is doing something really interesting, and I think it would really be really great if they had the opportunity to present this to the directors. Something as simple as that. It's something to really consider. And the next slide is frightening, so I'll preference it. There are issues in the Bay Area with this. I would imagine that some of you are aware. It was in the news quite a bit a few years ago, and it's kind of died down a little bit. These are just some of the headlines of women that were kind of like experiencing really tough time in industry. There's pay inequality issues, there's harassment issues, there's just general opportunity advancement to leadership positions, and there has to be something more that we can do. One is to think about how are we going to help people negotiate salary. And I hope you have some opportunities to practice negotiating salary before you have to negotiate salary. I will make a blanket statement, and anybody that wants to shoot me is welcome to shoot me over it. Women suck at negotiating salary. There, I said it. It's so true. It's terrible. Women are terrible at it. So when you see these issues with diversity and pay inequality, some of it starts there. And it also, they'll also hear these statements with, well, you know, we just don't have as many women who are qualified for these positions, or and that's why we don't have as big of a population of women, or the scales are not nearly as equal. Part of that is the way that the job ads are written. They are written like everything is in there, including the kitchen sink. And it's described as they want someone who has a background in business, but who can also deploy a database, who can also do analysis, who also has some computer science background, and maybe who can also deploy like some kind of enterprise, something or other. And oftentimes when women look at those types of job ads, they say, oh, well, I'm not 100% qualified, so I'm not even gonna apply. But men, on the other hand, is like, ah, I could do some of these things, I'm gonna apply. So the pool of men that applies is much larger than the pool of women, when there's plenty of women that are equally qualified to the men that are applying. So we have to do more to encourage women to apply and not to just take that laundry list and say, oh, I can't take off everything here, so I'm not gonna apply. Apply for everything. Let the companies decide whether or not you are qualified or not qualified. I mean, obviously, please don't apply for a position as a lawyer at a firm if you don't have a law degree. But if you know something about business and something about GIS, and there's a job opening for someone who is going to do spatial intelligence for business, apply. Don't get caught up in all the listed terms that they have there. Give them the opportunity to speak to you, because for one, they may not recognize that it's not realistic to have a candidate that's going to have all these skills, and you might know that right off the bat. And you might be the one to educate them in the interview process that, hey, this unicorn that you're looking for, not happening. The way that this field works is people specialize in these certain areas, and to build up a team that does what you need them to do, you should really have, you know, a person who's dedicated to the database side and a person who's dedicated to the analysis side, something to that effect. So there's all these horror stories. I mean, just off the record, I will say when I was at Apple, I never had any experience like these poor women had. I never felt unsafe. I never felt discriminated against. I didn't feel that way when I worked at MapsN, which was funded by Samsung, although it is kind of interesting to work for an international company. I'm really happy that I currently now work for an American company. It's very different. And then this clothing company that I haven't really mentioned too much about, this doesn't even register with them. So when I was still getting like these Twitter alerts about, oh my gosh, this is happening at GitHub and somebody's having this awful experience, I just imagined that everyone at Gap would be talking about it. But no, it's not even part of their culture. They don't have issues, these types of issues, because they're not a tech company. So I'm really fortunate. I have a tech job, but it's not a tech company. So some of this weirdness doesn't occur. I remember when I first started there, there was this really nice young woman who, she manages new initiatives for the company, like new store concepts. And she invited me to lunch. And I was so excited. And so she's like, yeah, I'll meet you in the cafe. So I went up to the cafe, and I was so excited. I'm going to meet my friend Caroline. And I couldn't find her. There were so many women in the room. I was so not used to that, because I had been working for these companies where I was like the only one. And I just figured, oh, I'll just look for the only other woman. And you can't do that when you work for a non-tech company. It's only in the tech industry do you find it so skewed. And when I think about my leadership chain, my current leadership chain, it's predominantly women. And the CFO of the company is a woman. She's fantastic. My director, my senior director, they're women. They're very successful. And so it just goes to show that this isn't the case everywhere in the Bay Area. But you have to keep this in mind for companies like Apple and Google and, you know, Samsung. There might be some interesting things that you have to grapple with. And it's probably the last thing you want to think about when you're just trying to do finance or do business intelligence. So I told you who I was, the independent scholar who might work for a clothing company. I wanted to impress upon you that we really are all cartographers. If you are making a map, then you should really embrace that, because there are a lot of other people that have embraced that. In the time that I've been working in industry, I would say most of the people that I've worked with have not been classically trained. A lot of them are media arts people. They make incredibly beautiful maps, but they don't know anything about projections and coordinate systems. And they really don't know too much about, like, you know, what's appropriate with respect to symbology, but boy, do they make beautiful maps. And sometimes that's all you need. That's what sells. Data being everywhere, if you feel a little bit of heat, a little bit uncomfortable about the prospect of working with big data, you need to address that now. You need to find some way to gain access to big data and just try. And find other people that you can communicate with. Maybe make friends with some people in the computer science department. And finally, learn this and that proactively. This is the hard part. You only have so much time in the day. to actually pursue all these other skills. I can push on faculty to, you really need to integrate this, but how can they? There's only, 18 months, I think, is like a typical time frame for an MBA program, and going beyond that makes the departments less marketable with respect to students. They want to finish fast. But it doesn't mean that you only have to get it here. You might be able to continue once you get to industry. It's just like you have to go outside of your comfort level. And I'm encouraging you, if you get a seat at the table, you can't shrink. You can't let the IT people, the computer scientists, and the data scientists run away with everything because they have a skill set that goes beyond what you've been exposed to. You need to just like belly right up to that table and express that you have these amazing ideas and you would like to partner with them.
So I guess the last thing that I will say is that as far as academia, industry, the Bay Area versus not the Bay Area, the grass is just green. It's not more green on one side or the other. There's like all these opportunities, and maps are really hot right now. So I encourage you to stay thinking geospatially, because it's gonna provide you with a lot of opportunities, and I really hope to see some of you in industry. So thank you.